this is about as comfortable as I get with snakes here. I did greet Professor Snake going into the office, our pet therapist for today. I got a lot closer that people give me props for. I didn't scream too loud. I kept her control. My mic wasn't on yet. But I greeted Professor Snake and just got out of his way as respect. And Professor Snake is warming up in the office, so if you'd like to greet Professor Snake after worship service, I'll let all of you go before me. Lisa and I will just make sure that everyone gets through first, and then we may not be found when Professor Snake doesn't have anyone else to visit. So I'm not really a Bible thumper, but today, you know, with snakes, there's a lot in the Bible. Jamie and Naomi probably thought this was coming, so I just want to remind you what God's word was for today. From Genesis chapter 3:15, and I will put a conflict between you, meaning humans, and the snake, between you and the woman, Eve, and between you, the seed, and her seed, and the snake shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the head. So, I mean, I don't make this up. This is in the Bible, right? But on a redeeming note, snakes, you know, we don't get along. I try to stay their way. But snakes are seen as a miracle. Yes, snakes are a miracle. In Exodus chapter 7, it was when Moses and Aaron were going to Pharaoh and trying to convince Pharaoh to let the Israelites go, that Aaron, actually in this case, had a staff and threw it on the ground, and it became like a serpent, and all of the Pharaoh's magicians and advisors tried to figure out how that happened. But ultimately, a snake was one of the miracles that convinced Pharaoh to let God's people go. So see, snakes can be a good thing. Ginny has been posting Snake Week on Facebook of all the wonderful things that snakes do. I'm still not convinced. So that's just me. I'm a skeptic. So as we begin worship today with our announcements, we're about halfway through. This is a wonderful book. We kind of got through the meat and potatoes of it, of the deep scholarly stuff. So now we're talking about Love is Doubt. This wonderful old book, Faith After Doubt, Why Your Beliefs Stop Working and What You Can Do About It. It's talking about how we get kind of in a rut in our lives when what we've learned as children or young adults, these first wave of Christianity, how that may not always apply, and how, especially in recent years, with the changes in our society, especially with COVID, how we get through these doubts that we may have and go towards a prosperous faith and prosperous relationship with God. Christine, you want to come up? Got an announcement about game night coming up.
We have an August game night, Friday, August 25th, from 6 to 8. We need more euchre players because we have like some that are left out of the game waiting. So, I mean, it's hard to get the correct even numbers, but it's become euchre night mostly. And they're very serious about it. I don't play, so I just sit and watch them. It's pretty cool. And bring a snack to share if you want, or one for just you and your family. I am looking for more board game donations. A lot of the games that I got, I noticed they're extremely old and outdated. If you have any games in your house, board games or card games that you are no longer wanting to have in your house, then bring it to church. During the week, you can bring it to the office, or you can just bring it to game night. And thank you.
At this time, I want to invite all of you to rise in spirit and body and greet one another in God's peace. So I know the school year is about to begin. Some have already begun or gotten finished up with summer plans. So this is a wonderful time with birthdays and graduation parties and school, all that going on. Maybe you've got a list to spruce up or get ready for the school year. We do have our script gift cards available, so it's a wonderful way that you don't pay any extra money, maybe a small fee if you do the online wallet gift card, but this goes directly to the church. You pay the dollar amount, so if you're doing $100 to like Lowe's or Home Depot or even restaurants, the church gets that the percentage of that. Usually it's 4 to 14%. So it's a wonderful way that you don't have to even change your habits except, you know, playing ahead just a little bit. Chris and I have done some home repairs recently, and it's been a wonderful experience to help us do with home repairs, but also benefit the church. So Bruce and Earth of Gifts, the ones who launched this program, so it's a wonderful way to get involved and just help the church out by, you know, doing a little bit of shopping and helping yourself out as well. My last thing that I have to look forward to is, even though school is starting, our program year has not started yet officially. So after Labor Day, we are looking to launch our program year, especially for our Sunday school program. And that means Mess Fest is coming up. So if you haven't done Mess Fest before, come participate, come be part of messiness, or be part of the splash zone, as I call it. But it's a time for all ages, not just children, to get excited about our program year starting off. Our ministry is kicking back into action after some time of rest and relaxation for our summertime. So look forward to next worship next week, as we'll let you know more plans about our whole church kicking off for Rally Sunday. But let's begin worship with our call to worship. Come on up, Walter.
O God embodied, the one made flesh who dwelt among us, help us to arrive this morning with a yes. A yes to our faith that says our bodies are good and holy, just as and however they are. A yes to show up here, even if our minds may be in other places at times. A yes to believing enough in you, this community, and our own call, to know this is where we need to be in this moment.
A yes to bring all that comes from and through our hearts to you, O heart maker.
Come, let us bring ourselves to this place of worship and plenty, with our inherent worth and dignity to guide us. And all together we pray. Our scripture passage shows us the power of repentance. And how profound is it to see this embodied in Christ, who changed his perspective and actions because of an encounter with the force of mother advocating for her child and dignity. May we have the courage to admit when we've been wrong, the courage to ask for forgiveness, and the open heart to change our ways. May God be gracious to us and bless us and make God's face to shine upon us, that your way may be known upon earth and your saving power among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the people with equity and guide the nations upon earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you.
The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, has blessed us. May God continue to bless us. Let all the ends of the earth revere God. And from Matthew 15, Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." He answered, I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. But she came and knelt before him, saying, Lord, help me. He answered, It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs. She said, Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. And then Jesus answered her, Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish. And her daughter was healed from that moment.
While we're waiting, just a shout out to Rob and Barb for making us these awesome shirts.
When the stars came crashing down in tiny pieces to the ground, I was all alone down here, trapped beneath the atmosphere. Then I thought somebody called my name, spun around and caught a flame, gave in to a God I didn't know. And now everything is falling into place. A brand new life is calling and I owe it all to grace. It's so much brighter living in your world, saving what you did for me. You gave me something I want everyone to see. When we stumble and it all goes wrong, only you can make it right. So I say, oh, I'm learning to be the light. Melted with advice, no one wants to listen to the list of things you shouldn't do. So I build a city on a hill, light a candle on a sill, knowing you'll be knocking at my door. Oh God, I just want to love on everyone. All I have is yours to give, so let your people come. So much brighter living in your world, saving what you did for me. You gave me something I want everyone to see. But when we stumble and it all goes wrong, only you can make it right. So I say, oh, I'm learning to be the light. The shadows hide, the light that breaks the curse of pride, the light that takes the weary in its arms. When it all came crashing down, there was only darkness all around, but in the distance I could see a flame. It's so much brighter living in your world, saving what you did for me. Something I want everyone, I mean everyone, to see. When we stumble and it all goes wrong, only you can make it right. So I say, oh, I'm learning to be the light. I'm learning to be the light. Whoa, whoa, I'm learning to be the light.
Thank you. Thank you, CrossWords, for that motivational, inspiring piece. Well, Ruthie looked at this today and was like, wow, that dog's really well behaved. How does it sit so still? Lloyd's like, whatever, not real. Fake news, right? So, if I had to offer you these two things, bowl A or bowl B, what would you choose?
Bowl A.
A? No one wants B? Look how happy this dog is. This dog is real happy with B. Yeah, you're not dogs, right? So this is as close as I could get to our Bible reading. So this is breadcrumbs, bread from the master's table, or talking about dogs, you know, that this woman is beneath or insulted. So we have very little things. So if you wanted breadcrumbs or real food, but I gave you dog food, would you be really mad at me? Would you be insulted? Would you eat it?
Yeah.
Watch out, Mom and Dad, right? Yeah. Good thing you don't have a dog. I mean, maybe Sonic's been missing. So in our gospel message today, there's a woman whose daughter is in need of healing. And she goes to Jesus and she's crying out, help my daughter, help heal my daughter. And Jesus says, he's basically kind of insulting her and says, you know, this is bread. This is food for the servants of Israel, the Jewish people. You know, you're not one of them. So here, you're like a dog, eat the dog food. And she's shocked, but she doesn't give up because her daughter needs to be healed. So Jesus, in this situation, is not very acting. He's not practicing what he preaches. So she corrects him and says, you know, even dogs eat from master's table the crumbs that fall from these breadcrumbs. You know what Jesus does? He changes his mind and he heals the woman's daughter. And he says, woman, because of your faith, your daughter is healed. So, I'm trying not to insult you, but you can eat dog food, I guess. Don't know if it's meant for human consumption. Probably not, right? But if I insulted you by giving you dog food, you'd say, get out of here. I'm not going to eat that. I'd rather have the breadcrumbs. Right? So, sometimes we make mistakes. But it's us to learn from that to make the situation better, even if we've made a bad move or a mistake. Because Jesus, in our story today, he gets so focused on his ministry that he doesn't realize that there's people that are around him that need help, that are sometimes beyond his own scope, if you will. Sometimes in our own lives, we turn people away. We don't have enough time for them or enough emotions for them. We make mistakes. So it's up to us to follow Jesus' teaching and to say, I'm sorry I did that. Come into the fold of God and be part of God's beloved community. So can you repeat after me as we pray today? Holy God, let us learn from our mistakes. Let us show love to all of your people.
When we insult others,
let us greet them with embrace of love.
Let us love others
and forgive others
as you have forgiven us.
In your holy name,
amen.
If you ever wondered if dogs existed back in biblical times, wonder no more, because dogs are mentioned quite a few times in the Bible, both in the Hebrew Bible and in the New Testament, except dogs are mentioned kind of indirectly. There's no, you know, Lassie story of a dog being a hero. There's no, no really good stories about dogs. No hero story, I should say. There are a lot of dog stories, but it's mostly about dogs' behavior, and you could probably imagine where that's going. Dogs do weird and sometimes very unusual and unclean things. I saw this yesterday with some things that my dog did. I'm going to leave Lily out of this. You can ask her yourself. But the scripture we're provided with today is about context in our gospel reading about these unclean things that animals and especially dogs do. So as a dog owner myself, Lily does weird things. Like run and hide when the stove comes on because she hears that beeping that the smoke detector might go off. Or we took her swimming down in Ohio this weekend to get away, to go to this secret or hidden beach that we were part of in our last community. And so Lily would get in the water, get all wet, and then she'd go roll in sand and then be like, oh no, I'm all crusty now. I don't know about that. Or sometimes one thing that Kristen might be embarrassed that I'd share, but she's not here to stop me, is that Lily, being a larger dog, will go up on our countertop and take the butcher knife out of the butcher block and come around the house. not running around, but she says, okay, I need a treat. So dogs do weird things, and sometimes they're unclean. But even with all this to say that Lily is a blood member of my family and God's larger family, but she's still a dog and still does weird and unclean things. But have you ever been so focused, so consumed by the task or project at hand that you lose sight of the mission you start out on? You look past the people and say, I don't have time for you. I need to get this done. I don't have time to listen to your problems, best friend or family member. I need a deadline that's happening tonight. Sometimes pastors and caregivers get so consumed, especially the last couple years of the pandemic and everything that's changed within our society with technology, that we experience something called compassion fatigue. It's something in my last community I admitted to, and I shared with my clergy cluster in my own church, that I was so consumed with the secondhand trauma of everyone's situations in life, from death to battling disease and cancer to situations happening in their own lives and in my own firsthand life, that sometimes I had no vessel that was full. It was overflowing with my own situation, my own emotions, and those in my congregation. We see in our story today that it opens up with Jesus teaching the crowd about being with the unclean, about fulfilling God's word, about coming to those who are seen as outcast, those who are seen as oppressed, and those who are seen as outside the beloved fold of God, and welcoming them in. Jesus often criticized the Pharisees time and time again because they said, you are so consumed with spending time with sinners. And Jesus said, yes, this is the will of God. But here, within an earshot of this teaching that Jesus is doing, here comes a woman who is not of the Jewish faith, who is seen as unclean, and she challenges Jesus directly. Now, before we understand why the situation has such an important part, we hear about Jesus going back and forth throughout the Gospels with the Pharisees as arguing who's unclean or who's righteous in God's beloved community. So before we understand where this lesson that Jesus learns from his own mistakes, this own redemption, we hear of other times that Jesus may be making a mistake. It's up for you to decide. So throughout the Gospels, Jesus and the Pharisees is welcoming them in with, we hear about Nicodemus and later Joseph of Arimathea. Jesus and the Pharisees often call each other names. Of course, Hippocrates is one, but Jesus also calls them blind guides or fools. He calls the scribes and Pharisees as whitewashed tombstones full of dead bones and uncleanliness. He calls them serpents. He calls them generations of vipers ready to strike. And he calls them hypocrites. He says, you are graves because you are full of nothing but emptiness. So that's a little context of what's going on, this situation of back and forth. But this story that we have today isn't about a miracle story about how Jesus learns from his own lessons to remind himself of God's message of abundant love, that he was sent out of love. This is a story of where Jesus gets it wrong. He makes a mistake. His fully humanness is being shown. But we learn about this fullness, this redemption, because the two people that are pointed out in the gospel lessons throughout the four, the two people who are known for their great faith, are not even of the Jewish faith. Here we hear this woman who is pleading for healing of her daughter who is possessed by a demon, who is lifted up for her great faith, but also a Roman centurion who is called and healed. His servant is healed because of his great faith. The two people lifted up are beyond the realm of God that Jesus is fulfilling at this time. So we don't know much about the woman's own background, other than she is not of the Jewish faith, but is traditionally known through midrash of performance and teaching from the Hebrew Bible that her name is Justa. Justa, which recalls that her own original struggle with the Hebrew people and the indigenous people of the land is also recollects the Canaanite woman and genealogy of Rahab, Jesus' lineage, who is often identified as a prostitute, and probably Tamar, who is also a descendant of Jesus. So we come to this teaching story today when this woman who has a daughter who is being tormented by a demon and who needs healing. She's persistent, as the disciples say, this woman is getting in our way. She is squawking. She is making a scene. Send her away, Jesus, so we can be done with her. The woman is undeterred as Jesus and the disciples push her away or try to keep this barrier between them. Jesus, in this mindset, is only coming for the Jewish people. He is to be reminded, and this woman reminds him, of John 3:16, for God so loved the entire world that they can believe in him. So again, undeterred, she repeats her message in their plea to please heal my daughter. Please have mercy, Lord, for she needs to be healed, and you can do that. I believe in you. So Jesus then insults her by saying that I'm not here to help non-Jews for food or graces, only for the children of Israel, the lost sheep. And so a third time she is undeterred and she seeks mercy and says, Lord, have mercy on my child and me. Now some people, some Christians would go forth and say, well, Jesus is only testing her. They want to see how genuine her faith is. But is it really a test? Does the beloved child and representative of God's love for us, who's veiled in flesh, really test people? I don't sit comfortably with this passage that Jesus is testing people. I think that Jesus is so consumed with the message of God, the ministry and mission at hand, that he looks past others and relearns what it means to be focused on God's mission of sharing testimony and truth of a more designated and open love. This message of being a dog is directly an insult. As I said, dogs do weird and unclean things. It's not a term of endearment or compassion or even dismissal. It is saying, you can't handle this. It could be away with you. You're a second-class citizen, if you will. So you can't even eat food from the master's table. But this woman is undeterred. Because for her, there is love that is to be found. This dog, as we might see in America, is a beloved, cute puppy, this ambassador of love and comfort when you come home to greet you unconditionally. That's not what's going on. Dogs in this time were a pest. They had fleas, they had ticks, they had all kinds of problems going on with them, and they often slept outside, keeping the pests away. But they were an animal of the streets. They were unwelcomed. They were not a member of the family. They were often used for keeping the sheep in line or keeping a working approach. So this is where Jesus falls into the trap that I was talking about, of being so consumed with our own tasks, our own world around us, that we miss out on those around us. This teaching is not coming from Jesus this week. It's coming from the woman who is undeterred by her faith, this desperate need to be seen and heard and embraced by Jesus. When Jesus is teaching about unclean things, this dog comes to mind. But the woman is in it with an earshot, and she comes to Jesus and says, all right, I'm going to call you out. You need to practice what you preach here. And so being undeterred out of her own desperation, she is the one doing the teaching. This message that we hear in the second part of our gospel about Jesus fully welcoming after his own mistake, this own concentrated mistake, is more about God's beloved community. It's more consistent about what the Gospels are about and what Jesus' ministry is about, to have faith in unexpected places and at unexpected times. Here, the teacher is this woman who is seen as a second-class citizen in her own time for being a woman, but then also as an outsider of not being of the Jewish faith. She says to him, Lord, have mercy. You talk about unclean things. I am considered unclean, but heal me anyway. In the end, throughout the Gospels, we hear of the Roman centurion and this woman, who is not of Jewish faith, being lifted up as the greatest faith of them all. So last week we heard about Peter's faith, about stepping out of the boat, about having courage to speak up, to act out in courageous times of our own faith. But we learned that the teaching last week was to have courage, to have those moments of great faith, to step out in action, in word, in deed, but then get back in the boat. For the church has been courageous for all times and all places. The church often moves slow, as some people will notice, not necessarily in our church. I'm not calling you out. I'm saying the church universal acts slow, but that's why churches are still around almost 2,000 years later. We see the urgent need in our own society, we act upon it. But when we are passionate about the things that can, that are about societal changes, about embracing this universal and unconditional gift of communion where all are welcome, about standing up for people's reproductive rights and their own dignity and their rights to marriage, we need a societal change. And so the church takes time to get it right, even if we are delayed on the scene. It takes time to organize after natural disasters like in Hawaii to make sure that the resources that we're pledging to get where they need. It takes time as we welcome refugees and people with looking for a new start like our family from Afghanistan. It takes time to organize to make sure we don't fall flat on our face, to learn their culture, their language, so that we don't try and insert things like, hey, come welcome our dogs, Lily. Because Lily is not welcome in many of those societies. They're seen as unclean. It takes time for us to get it right. So this message this day is for us to take our time, to take a pause from those missions, those ministries, those passions in our own lives that caused us to look past those who are most in need of healing, most in need of our own affection, and most in need of hearing God's word. Sometimes even pastors suffer from compassion fatigue. And so it takes us time to pray, to be with God, to be with God's people, to make sure we're doing it right. The teaching this week is about redemption. It's about learning from others that we don't take ourselves too highly, but instead humble ourselves. To learn to be urgent about our needs, to express it to this community here in Christ, but also to God that our needs are met and fulfilled. Churches are a place of healing, and we are the hands and feet that do that. But amongst our actions of courage, of faith, like we learned last week, we need to do these things together. At times, the church needs to ask for redemption. We've hurt our members, not necessarily this church, but the church universal, to provide healing, to step out in faith, to act on others' behalf, like we see the need right now in Ukraine, in Hawaii, in our own community. Let us be about faith and courage. Let us be about learning about being a closer walk, learning from our own mistakes. God's redemption and God's love are for all. But let us take time to make sure our focus is where it needs to be. So may it be so. Amen. God, you hear it through. But let us rise in spirit and body as we sing together, "This Is My Song." Thank you. seated as we share our joys, concerns, our dreams, our heartache, and all that we have in common. If you have a prayer, concern, something to lift up, please raise your hand and our ushers will make sure your voice is heard.
Please continue to keep Sherry Tudrick in your prayers. And thank you, whoever brought the altar flowers in. They are beautiful.
Well, lift up Sherry Tudrick as she is still in the hospital in the ICU recovering from complications from surgery. And we ask for blessings of this space of beauty and for all that we bring this day for worship.
May God watch over all of our children as they return to school and those returning to college for smart decisions and having good times.
We ask for prayers for our children, for our families, for our teachers, for the start of a new school year that may be about peace and community and unity, and that we can learn to solve our problems with their words and not other means.
Continue prayers for those that are suffering from the fires, not only in Hawaii, Maui, but Canada, Greece, and the state of Washington is also burning nowadays.
We ask for prayers of those who are in harm's way of natural disasters, for wildfires on the West Coast, for Canada, for especially Hawaii, that we can find a way. I know in the UCC there are ways that we can benefit, especially those in Hawaii, with picking up a piece of their lives.
Prayers for the people in California and the West who are going to experience the first tropical storm in a lifetime and don't know what to do with it. And prayers for peace in Europe and in the world.
We lift up those who are picking up the pieces after a tropical storm hit Southern California, something that's unexpected for them. And we encourage to ask for peace and a peace process in Ukraine, in Russia, and across our world.
Prayers for Guy McFarland. His mother passed away this week. Maxine was 99 years old. You may remember Guy. He was a longtime member of the Resurrection Brass. So prayers.
We ask for prayers for the McFarland family as losing Guy's mother, that we can find peace. So we can find a chance for legacy and remembrance, and then move on by being a message of true love that is abundant.
I don't know if they like when I call them out, but I do randomly, maybe like twice a year. Thank you, Brad and Barb, for being there for me, for bringing me to church and bringing me home, being my mentors. From the moment I walked into this church 8 years ago until now, you have been very close friends, and I love you both.
We lift up those who are leaders and mentors in our lives through the ways that we give our gifts of compassion and knowledge. We lift up wonderful mentors and stewards of faith, Brad and Barb, for their compassion and generosity.
We give thanks that Don is slowly healing from his fall, and we give thanks that our son-in-law is healing from cancer, and he had his third round of chemo out of six. He has three more to go, and then he'll have a maintenance treatment for several years after, and we're thankful for that.
Praise God for Don's healing after a fall several weeks ago. May God be with Joe as he's at the halfway point of his chemo regimen, and that God continues to strengthen Joe and heal his body from the inside out. I continue to ask for prayers for those who are grieving. Kristen and I spent some time with some friends from a previous community that grief in our lives, though we may think it's gone, it pops up in unusual ways. So we ask for prayers for all who are grieving from recent grief and for grief from many years ago, that trauma and process never truly goes away, but that we can be with those who grieve this day and those who experience loss. So let's take all these things, spoken and unspoken, and lift them up to God in the sacred space. I invite you to close with me with the Lord's Prayer. So let us be at peace, a moment with God. God, we are so grateful for the messages that you reveal in your holy word, the testimony of our lives, letting us be part as your spirit moves and calls us forward. God, we continue to ask for prayers for those who are picking up the pieces of their lives, for wildfires, of tropical storms, of the destructive ways of nature. God, let us be the agents of change, the warm embrace as people pick up their lives, as people continue to look for loved ones who are lost to them. May they be reconnected in this life. May we find ways to act through our denomination, through the Red Cross, through the wonderful ways that our gifts, financial gifts of generosity, of prayers, of the wonderful things that we can act and should act to be a beloved community that is real, that is all-encompassing, where your love and peace know no end. God, we ask for prayers of healing and guidance and protection upon our families, our children, and our teachers as they return to school for a new start. Let it be full of hopes and dreams, of excitement. Let us block out and protect in our ways our communities, that way, those ways of destruction and despair. Let us be about healing in a new way forward. God, we ask for continued prayers for Don's recovery and for our strength to be with Joe and our prayers as he's halfway, that Joe can continue to battle cancer successfully. And God, we ask for the memory and legacy to be with the McFarland family, to be in this time of grief, but to be felt by God through our prayers, to have time with family to move from memories and heartfelt laughter to honest, prepared ways of legacy. God, let us fill this space of despair with your love that knows no end, that we can be there to support them and hold them in prayer. God, we ask you to fill this space, to fill our lives with learning, that we can learn to be humble, that we can learn to pause from our courageous acts to find a time for redemption, a time of renewal, and a time to seek grace when we have stepped across boundaries and caused division. God, hear all the prayers spoken and unspoken in this time. And as this church and as these people who gathered here, let us prepare our hearts, our actions, and come full on with our momentum for our program year, which is just a couple weeks ahead. Let us lean into the excitement that the children have of Sunday school and our ministries coming alive again. May your spirit be with all of us to learn to be a spirit of resurrection, a spirit of hope, of new ways and new ways of doing things. God, you are a God of possibilities. So let us lean close to your presence. So God, we as your disciples who have a role to play, not only this day, but every day, help us to remember the word that you spoke for us, the lessons you teach for our daily living. As we lift up at this moment the prayer that you taught us to say together,
our Creator God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
At this time, we will receive our morning offering to share in the learning and wonderful embrace that God has for us. A time to reflect on the music played and how we play a role in the shaping of the church, in the shaping of our spiritual lives, in the shaping of the world at hand. We all have a role to play. So let God's Spirit speak to you at this moment. Let's gather our offerings right now.
Mm-hmm.
join me in our prayer of dedication? Let us give thanks for all that we share. May our gratitude for this community and the Spirit's presence in this space guide us and show up in our lives. May we know how to give, but also how to receive. How to say yes, and when we need to say not today. Let us lift up and take in the gift of thanksgiving. Amen. I invite you to come and greet Professor Snake, our pet therapist. I have my snake right here, so I don't need to get too close. It's all for you, you know. That's, I go to no ends. So seriously, go get a donut, grab, or touch Professor Snake if he's greeting in that way. If not, just come up to his enclosure. I invite you to get excitement, to feel alive as we are getting ready to kick off the program year in just a couple weeks. So bring your excitement next week as we announce our plans for kicking it off. And I invite you to close with me in our benediction. May God's extravagant welcome go with us wherever we go. May we learn what it means to belong as God's beloved and extend this acceptance out in the world. Let us remember that with deep love, the waters of justice flow. And with grounding in our own dignity, the fire of freedom lights up the world. Amen. Go in peace.